In this episode, I talk about my biggest fountain pen pet peeves, if black-coated nibs write any different than regular ones, and writing with a pen in the dark. Hey there, Brian Goulet here of GouletPens.com, and it is episode number 128 of Goulet Q&A. That's a lot of Q&As, I just gotta say. 128 feels like a mouthful, and yeah, it's kind of cool. I've done a couple of interviews in the last week that aren't going to be posting for a while, but it's kind of interesting because a Q&A always comes out as kind of a main, you know, kind of thing, and when they start to talk about how many questions I've answered in this Q&A, it's kind of crazy. So thank you all for continuing to send me questions. I'm always open to more of them. Yeah, I'm starting the video and already drinking water. So I've been up to some interesting stuff. I did not, did not have kind of a normal Q&A last week because I announced me and Rachel's very tragic news of our miscarriage. It's a little over 2 weeks now since that happened. So it's still very raw, but I gotta say the feedback that we got was just really heartfelt and almost kind of overwhelming. I mean, it's kind of a tough thing to go through in general, and I won't rehash it all again this week, but that pretty much dominated the conversation, especially on YouTube last week. So thank you all for your heartfelt comments. That really meant a lot, and I tried to respond to everybody personally. So we're still working through that. We're doing okay. It's a grieving process. It's gonna take some time. But I'm considerably more upbeat this week than I was last week. Still kind of crazy because this week, we planned this a long time ago, but our kids are in vacation Bible school at our church this week, and Rachel and I both set out to volunteer this year, so it's like from 9 to 12 in the morning, so we're kind of doing that in the morning, we're working in the afternoons, and then we are going to be, you know, working at night to kind of make up for the lost time. But it's really fun. I mean, my kids did it last year. Rachel volunteered, I did not, so this is my first time actually volunteering for it, and I gotta say it's pretty fun. So it's a kind of a neat experience. There's like 85 kids, 90 kids, something like that, doing it at our church, so it's pretty good size, pretty coordinated thing, but it's kind of neat to be involved in that. And we are in like a very low commitment kind of role. We're basically like the crew guides that like help just shuttle the kids from one place to another and take kids to the bathroom when they need to go, and we're kind of the adult that's managing the teenagers that kind of are hanging with the kids, and so we're kind of like the parents of the group and stuff like that. So it's a pretty fun thing, and it's neat that we're able to do that. The reason we do that is because we have a service week that we offer here to all of our staff. For anybody who's been here for a year or more, we give an extra week of paid vacation for them to volunteer for a nonprofit, and we have historically not followed through on that ourselves. So Rachel did it last year. I'm doing it now with Rachel this year. So it's kind of cool to actually be able to kind of lead by example in that respect. But that's been really fun. We have some product related things. I don't have a ton of updates for this week, but we do have Filofax that we're planning to launch next week. So that's pretty exciting because we've been planning for that. Gosh, we started talking initially about it in January. And it's been kind of since then that we've been planning it out. It's a big deal, a lot of photography involved. I'm not going to have a video at launch because it just didn't happen with all of the personal stuff that I have going on. It's a lot to really kind of put together. But we're looking in the next couple of weeks after our launch to come out with some kind of video on that. So look out for that. But if I don't have anything in video form at launch, just be aware that, you know, that's why. And then we're also really behind on or out of stock on our Leuchtturm notebooks, especially the dot grids, because they've been really popular with bullet journaling taken off and everything. So we're supposed to get a pretty good restock of that in July. That's all I know is July. So it's probably going to be several weeks more towards the end of July, I'll say, just to give myself a little bit of breathing room there. But that's definitely going to be a anticipated restock, so we're excited about that. And then next week, it's not going to be quite a regular Q&A, just because Jenny, our videographer, who's awesome, she is going to be on vacation, so she is not going to be here to do all the heavy lifting on the editing as normal. She has been working ahead of time, though, to actually edit an interview I did with Myke Hurley back when I was in Atlanta, so we'll be publishing that next week at the normal Q&A time. And then we'll come back the following week and pick back up with a regular Q&A. So you won't get the live questions from me next week. I apologize about that. You can still ask them though, and we'll save them and maybe answer them the following week. But and that's it. We got some other kind of, you know, things going on, and and what not, as always, but that's the major stuff that I've gotten. So let's get right into the questions. I've got some pen and writing questions. This is from @AltHaven on Twitter. Asks, what is your pet peeve regarding pens and inks? For me, slippery grips and bottles that don't fit larger pens. Yeah, definitely. I would resonate with both of those. The slippery grips, if it's like a super slick grip, yes. But I gotta say, like, the all metal grip doesn't bother me as much now as it used to. I think just the nature of the way I'm doing most of my writing is much more quick notes and stuff. If I'm sitting down for a long writing session, that's definitely the case. But I think for me, I have a bunch of different pens now. So it's not like having a pen with a slick metal grip is a total deal breaker like it used to be back when I was using pens. You know, to like sign handwritten notes for our invoices that we do here. When I would do that, it was in longer sessions. I'm not doing that quite as much these days. It's more quick notes and sitting in meetings and stuff. So the slickness doesn't bother me quite as much as it used to, but it's still not my preference. I will say the things that I'm going to talk about here are purely preferential. It's definitely not good or bad. A lot of them are products that I carry, so I still believe in them as good products. They're just not necessarily my personal preference. So some of my pet peeves, I guess, I have very large hands, so a lot of them are size-related things. So for example, I've talked about this many times, you loyal Q&Aers will know, the Lamy CP1, which is actually a fantastic pen. A lot of people really love it because it is so thin. It's about the size of a number 2 pencil in terms of its diameter. So it's a very popular pen. People like to carry it around. It's a great checkbook pen. But for me, the grip is too thin. It's just too thin and I can't stand it. So in pens that are this thin, I just don't like them very much. Unless it's, you know, for a specific purpose, like a carry around, like a pocket pen type thing, you know, like the Kaweco Fire Blue Lilliput. That one is also really thin, but I don't, you know, I use that just to carry around and write a quick thing. But yeah, the CP1 is just one of those pens that I get why people love it, but I just don't love it myself. Also short, really short grip sections. So a pen like the Faber-Castell Ambition, which is a fantastic pen, and I love the wood, but the grip section is really, really, really short. So it's basically, you can't just hold onto the grip section, and it's slick metal, so that's got like 2 knocks against it, right? I do still like this pen. I don't use it a lot, but when I hold it, I basically have to have like 1 or 2 fingers on the grip, and the other one I have to hold like way back on a completely different part of the pen. This pen gets, you know, some flack for the fact that it has such a short grip, and then it's got kind of this edge to it here on the wood that fits really on a kind of a weird place for a lot of people. So the Ambition is a pen that is beautiful, but not a lot of people necessarily love it for kind of those long writing sessions. It's not one of the more comfortable writing pens in that respect. Another thing that really bothers me, and this is a pen that I will discontinue carrying as a result, the Pelican Script. It was one of the first fountain pens that I ever used. It was in the first 5 pens that I ever used. I love the pen. It actually writes phenomenally well. The problem with it, and the problem with this and the Pelicano, is which is another great writing pen, but the problem is the converter does not fit snugly onto the grip of the pen. So it fits very kind of loosely, and if you don't really jam it on there and then treat it with kind of kid gloves, then the grip can just kind of pop off, which is especially problematic if you are filling and, you know, cleaning the pen, because then just the force that you're using to unscrew the converter and how you kind of lock it around can cause it to fall off, and then it kind of splatters in your sink or in your cup or desk or whatever that you're cleaning it, and then it can you know, have ink splatter that'll kind of go everywhere when it falls. Or when you're trying to fill it and it's in a bottle of ink, especially a particularly deep bottle of ink, and the grip can actually kind of fall off and go plop down into the bottle of the ink, and then you have to go fishing it out. That is super annoying. I don't really understand why it is that way, because I know it doesn't have to be so. But that is a deal breaker for me. Now, these pens do like have form-fitting inside, so that when the converter's in the pen installed, like, it actually kind of ratchets it down. So it's not a problem of writing, but it's a problem with filling and cleaning. So, and then you run into this situation, like literally I did just now, it'll actually hang up in the back of the pen when you go to take it off, and then you got to kind of pull it out like this, and then you get ink on your fingers, and it just seems unnecessary. So that's from a design aspect, it's not the greatest. But that is what's going on with that pen. It's not a lot of pens I run across that do that, but every now and then. Another one, and this comes from a pen that I really, really love. This is a Karas Customs ink. This one would be very stiff clips. Now, this is purely a preferential thing. It's not a good or a bad thing. But this clip is very stiff. It's stainless steel. It's very chunky. And the reason they design it this way is because they want this pen to be indestructible, which it really is. And if you're writing with it and you're, you know, wearing it on like your coveralls or your jeans or something like that, this is a clip that's going to hold up to that. That's not the way I end up carrying it most. You know, I'm in an office setting, so I don't need this like super ultra durable clip. For me, it makes it so that it's more difficult to use on like, you know, just like a polo type material. It's like the clip was too stiff. So that's very, very preferential thing, but really overly stiff clips is kind of another thing. Those are the major things for me for pens. There's like design aspects and stuff like that that are different, but those are kind of the functional things. And then talking about ink, since you asked about that too, I really can't stand weak pinky red inks. Ah, and there's so many of them too. You know, I think specifically about like platinum red, and there's like the Pelican red, like just the regular 4001 Pelican red. Even like Pelican Edelstein Ruby, I just don't really like it. And you know, there's so many reds that just lean pink and are kind of watered down, and this just doesn't seem necessary to me. So I don't like those. I really don't like boring, like mid-range kind of blah blues that have a little bit of purple color to it. Like that typical kind of just royal purple. It's really common, especially in inks that come from pen manufacturers, to have kind of that mid-range blue. I get it, because it's kind of like a school color. You know, it's like your typical, like you have a black and you have a blue. Well, usually the blue is kind of this general all-around purpley royal blue. But I just, I'm so sick of that, and there's so many of them out there, and I don't really like that particular shade of blue. I know I get very picky. I'm a huge fan of blue, but not that purpley blue. You take out the purpley part, and that's like the perfect color. I love that cerulean blue, like Liberty's Elysium is absolutely perfect. But yeah, just the blah kind of blues. And then I definitely resonate with you about, you know, bottles that don't fit larger pens. Jerbon is kind of notorious for this with their 1670 line of inks, which I think I actually have a couple right here. I forgot to grab it out a second ago, but they have just really thin necks. So I have a bottle of that. Oh, here we go. I got a Leuchtturm right here. So the bottles look gorgeous, but then when you actually uncap it and then you look at the actual diameter of the whole of the pen, you're not going to be able to fit your larger pens in here, especially if you like to use, you know, the larger like M800, M1000, Montblanc 149, anything in that range is going to be a problem for you. And then I would say not just the thin neck bottles, but the really shallow ones. Because I have a lot of pens that have like those larger number 6 nibs and things like that that are pretty good length to them. And with fountain pens, most of them, you need to fill from where the feed actually meets the grip of the pen. That's where it needs to fill from. So if you have a really shallow bottle of ink and you're trying to fill from all the way up here, if you don't have a lot of ink to dip into, you're not going to really be able to fill it very easily. And Jerbon, I love you. You make fantastic inks, but your 30 mil bottles, as gorgeous as they are really some of the least functional ones out there for this specific purpose. You know, when you look at where the bottom of that glass actually is for where you can dip your ink into, it just, you know, basically this is a full bottle and it's just barely able to cover the entire nib. And because of how shallow it is and the opening is not super wide, you can't really angle it that much either. So you're left to kind of tilting it and it doesn't tilt that well and all that. You know, it's beautiful. It's got like a pen rest and stuff like that, but it's really not super functional. I don't think they need to change it. I mean, if they did, that'd be cool, but, you know, it's totally their thing, but not one of my favorites in terms of bottle design. So I end up going with an ink syringe and just filling like that. Or if it's a converter pen, I'll pull the converter out and just fill directly from the bottle and then put it back onto the pen. So it's not like a total deal breaker, but if it's like, if I have to deal with that and I have another alternative, I'll be like, I'll just go with this other ink. So those are really kind of like my big things. None of them are like total deal breakers for me, but they're definitely a turnoff, I would say. All right, Beth S. on Facebook says, I saw in an older video about Monteverde nibs where Brian mentioned that there is a coating on the black nibs that give them the black color. Yes. Does this hold true for all black nibs? Does this coating cause them to write a little thicker than their steel counterparts? My dad and I both found our Lamy Dark Lilacs seem to not write as fine as our other Lamy pens of the same nib size. Okay, we got a couple of different things to dissect out of this one. Let's talk about black nibs in the first place. The most of the black nibs, most not all, that you're going to see are stainless steel nibs. So you're going to either see a polished steel, sort of like you have on, well, this is actually a titanium on this one. That's a bad example. Here, this one, this Pelican script here, it's a polished stainless steel, and then you have a black coated stainless steel nib on this Monteverde. Well, Monteverde, or who else has got it? Lamy, you mentioned Lamy, so I got a Dark Lilac Safari here, that's got a black coating as well. All of the black nibs are coatings. There's no black base metal that's used for manufacturing a nib. The closest thing you're going to get is titanium, which if you have a titanium nib, I knew there's a reason I had this, a titanium nib, which is going to be kind of a like gray color, kind of a matte gray. It's really not the same thing though. So that is a little bit different, but the black nibs themselves are all coated on something, whether it's a gold nib, like on the Pilot. Vanishing Point has black coated gold nibs, but these ones are black coated stainless steel. So it's the same stainless steel that you're getting on the polished steel, but with a black coating on it. That's literally the only difference. And really, it should not write any different. Now, there's different ways to coat the nib. You can do kind of like a, I don't know exactly the process that's used for Monteverde, but you can do just more of like a coating, like a lacquering type of coating, which I think that's more in the camp of where Monteverde is. I don't know. I haven't gotten a word on that. Lamy, I'm not exactly sure what they do either, but I would not be surprised if they were more in that vein, but they might be black oxide. I'm not sure. I know the Goulet black nibs and the Edisons are black oxide, which is a different process. And then you can also get what's called ruthenium, which is more like a gunmetal. That is actually a base element, but it's a coating on top of another thing. You don't get solid ruthenium nibs, and that's not a true black. That's sort of like a gunmetal color. So it's a little bit different scenario, but worth mentioning. So in terms of the black nibs themselves, they really shouldn't write any different. I think if they are, it's kind of a coincidence. And aside from that fact, you have the black coating, but really the tipping on the nib is going to be the same on all of these, no matter what color it is, or really no matter what material the nib is made out of too. There's tipping material that's on the tip of this, except for, of course, the pen that I have in my hand right here. This is a stub nib, a stub stainless steel nib, which does not have any tipping on it. So to backpedal a little bit, but the Lamy nib here, with everything except for the italic nibs and stub nibs, you're going to have tipping material on here, which isn't actually black coated anyway because they hone and polish them. So if you look at the tip, it's actually a little bit shiny because you're looking strictly at the actual metal that's used on the tipping. So even though it's a black nib, the tip itself is not going to be any different than it's going to be on a polished steel. So if there is any difference, I think it's just purely coincidental, and it may be that it was just made in a different batch or something like that. You know, Lamy especially, I mean, their quality control is pretty darn good, but especially when you get to some of their extra fine, maybe their fine nibs, there's a lot more handwork that's involved, and the thinner the nib, the finer the nib you get, the more you can notice a tolerance in the actual, you know, tip size when you're writing with it. So you're gonna see a little more variance anyway. So I think even just the fact that you have one nib size and then another nib size of the same pen, you might see a little bit of variance from one to another. Yeah, you're seeing that with your dad, and that's a bit coincidental, but that's definitely not like a universal thing. Like, oh yeah, if you have a black nib, it's always going to be fatter than your fatter writing than your polished steel. That's really not the case. And from the way that they make these things, there's really not that's not the explanation for that, if that's what's happening. So I hope that clears that up a little bit. Cool. I'll take a little sip of water before we move to the next question. All right. K8 Serenpix, I hope I said that right. That's from Instagram. Says that here's one that's been troubling me. Do you have any tips for writing in the dark? I sleep with a notebook and a pen by my bed to jot down thoughts or reminders, and usually think of something I want to write down just as the lights are out. That's how it goes, isn't it? Turning the light on is disruptive to others sleeping. Any ideas? Thanks. Well, unless you have some kind of night vision or superhuman power, you're going to need some kind of light to be able to see in the dark. The thing that I think is going to be most helpful, I mean, you could get like some kind of small flashlight or a cell phone light or something like that if you don't want to actually turn on the light in the room. One of the most useful things that I've ever seen, and I don't have one with me, I wish I did to actually show you, but Google finger lights. So it's a very small flashlight powered by lithium batteries, and it has like a rubber band on it, and you can actually attach it to your finger. Or you might even be able to attach it to your pen. So it's going to be a very small LED light that you can attach to either your finger or the pen, whichever makes more sense for your situation. And it's going to shine a light just right down to where it is that you're writing. It's going to be, you know, cast a light that's about this big in size, and then you're going to be able to write and see your writing, and it's not going to, you know, blast light across the whole room. And they're really pretty cheap, a couple of bucks. You might be able to find them locally, I don't know. Online they're pretty easier to find, but finger lights is the magic word that you're going to want to look for there. Noodlers used to have some of them. I'm not sure if they still do with some of their UV treated lights, with some of their UV inks. I'm not sure what's coming in now. Actually, I'll need to check, but they've changed their lights several times. But I know that's kind of where I first was introduced to them. I think that's going to be your answer. All right, I got one business question this week. This is from Pens and Tea on Instagram. How often does the bottom shelf stock get updated on your site? It's my favorite spot to shop. So I've talked about the bottom shelf before, and I know I have. However, I like to sometimes answer questions that I have addressed in past Q&As, because if it's been a while, our process might have changed, so there might be new stuff to talk about. So this is definitely one of those things that the bottom shelf process has evolved a bit over the 6 years that we've been doing it now. So for those of you that aren't aware, the bottom shelf is a place on our site that you can go and click to. I forget where we have it on our site now. If you go under, let's see here, specials. And it's the last thing under the specials kind of tab in our main menu. It's called the bottom shelf. And the idea is, you know, you have like your top shelf stuff, like your really good stuff, and the bottom shelf is like the stuff that's not as great, right? So it's all kind of our discounted things. It could be cosmetically flawed. It could be, you know, missing packaging. It could be something that was a return for preferential reasons that maybe we've inspected, but it's been used before, so we don't want to sell it as new. So it's all things that are in that situation. It might be, you know, we get a shipment of ink that comes in, you know, one of the ink bottles leaks and it leaks onto 7 or 40 others, and the labels are ruined or the boxes are ruined or something like that. We can't sell them as new. Yeah, we might be able to negotiate a credit back with the manufacturer, but if it's like 2 bottles, it's really not worth anybody's trouble to do that. So we just, you know, discount it, put it up on the bottom shelf. You get a deal. You know, if you don't care about the outer packaging of your bottle of ink, then what do you care anyway? You're just getting a cheaper bottle of ink and everybody's happy. So that's why we have the bottom shelf. So the only challenge with that is that it's not a consistent supply of really anything, because it's all just, you know, stuff that happens to come in either based on returns that we're getting, or damage in shipping, or a defective product or defective packaging of some kind that can happen. And so it's always kind of It's always kind of like a judgment call on our part of, is this something that's like big enough for us to try to get a credit back from the manufacturer, or should we just, you know, go ahead and list it on the bottom shelf? You know, we kind of weigh that out and how much time is involved in both ways. So, but the rhythm that we are pretty much on now is we will kind of gather up and collect things throughout the week. And then it's much more efficient for us to do all the bottom shelf listings at one time, because that's one thing. You're sitting down, you have all the products right there, you're creating the listings, we're making them live on the site, and we're not having to do it and kind of sprinkle it throughout the week, because that's kind of random. So what we usually try to do, because the rhythm works out nicely, we try to get them all done like either like Tuesday afternoon or Wednesday morning. That way, when we put the newsletter out on midday Wednesday, we have kind of the most bottom shelf listings, because when we put our newsletter out, we tend to get a spike in traffic, spike in, you know, you all well, you all come to our site when we send out the newsletter. That's kind of the point, right? So we like to have the bottom shelf listings in place when possible for the newsletter launch. So that's really helpful. So you can anticipate that when you are getting your newsletter, that's probably going to be the most bottom shelf items you're going to see for the next week, and then they usually go away pretty quickly, and then the following week they'll kind of come back again and again. It's not a steadfast rule. Sometimes we'll have some time later in the week and we'll catch up on listings anyway, or we'll be really light and not, you know, be worth the time to kind of go through and do a batch of them, so we'll skip a week or two, especially if we get heavy into the holiday season and we're just really understaffed. You know, we might wait a little bit on the bottom shelf, but it'll build up and we'll be like, okay, we really got to get on this. So, but that's pretty much how it ebbs and flows. And that's somewhat what our rhythm is, at least for the moment. All right, this next question is I got three actually, troubleshooting questions. These are all pretty, you know, writing related troubleshooting ones. So I could have probably put them under pens and writing, but I decided to slap them under troubleshooting. So this is Sosanolan on Instagram. I received a stealthy matte black pilot vanishing point and noticed there was some ink caked onto the nib. How do you recommend cleaning this off? And what is your preferred method of making household pen cleaner in a pinch between orders of your awesome Goulet pen flush, which I would certainly recommend? Thank you. I appreciate the plug there. I promise that's not why I chose the question. I'm actually going to tell you how to go without the pen flush. So. Yeah, so you have a vanishing point. You didn't say it was new. It shouldn't be caked up with old ink if it was new, so I'm assuming maybe you bought it on eBay or you got it from a friend or something like that. But if that's the situation, if you have an old vanishing point or any pen, really, that has tons of ink caked up on it, for one thing, pen flush is a really good way to go. It's you know, safe for pens. The only thing is it is ammonia-based, so you don't want to soak aluminum in it because ammonia reacts with aluminum, so you don't want to do that. But short of that, you're going to be pretty safe with that. There's a lot of like pen flush type solutions that are out there on Fountain Pen Network and other things like that. You certainly can make your own. I know it's easier for some folks than to others based on, you know, what chemicals you have available to you and whether or not that's something you really want to mess with much. And you know, you gotta buy that stuff in bulk and all that. So I would say that probably the easiest and safest solution for just your home remedy is gonna be just regular dishwashing detergent. Not like the stuff that you put in your dishwasher, but the dish soap, like the Dawn dish detergent, like you would use, you know, for a hand sponge when you're washing out your dishes. That stuff is super safe. I use that to wash my cars. It's really pretty friendly, and it's a really good surfactant that can really help to assist in cleaning, especially breaking down ink like this. So I would use a combination of that dish soap in water, just lukewarm water, maybe make it a slightly warm, but you don't want hot water ever. And you can soak your nib unit in that, and I would just leave it there overnight. And that's going to be pretty safe for pretty much any pen that you're going to be dealing with. The only thing that you're not going to want to do that is if you have a casein pen, C-A-S-E-I-N. That's a vintage material that's not used very much anymore. Casein, for whatever reason they made this pen, is an alternative to plastic, but it's kind of like a celluloid alternative, but it's absorbent, so it will soak up water. So you don't want to soak your casein pen, but other than that, you're going to be pretty safe with just water, dish soap, and then soaking it in there, and I think you'll be good. So in between your pen flushes, dish soap is definitely going to be your way to go. All right, this next question is from CSF Photo on Instagram. I have several Monteverde pens that tend to write a bit dry. I hold them slightly upright around 50 degrees. Is there such a thing as feed tuning? Could tuning or grinding the nib help in any way? Would my warranty with Yaffa cover any adjustments? I don't want them to be smoother. I just want the flow to improve a bit more. Thanks for the input. All right, you got a bunch of questions here that are all kind of interrelated, so I'll kind of take them one at a time. Is there such a thing as feed tuning? So, so here's a Monteverde pen right here. I will say, you know, some of the pens have written a bit dry before. I have definitely been passing that feedback up to Monteverde. You're not the only one that I've heard that from. It's not like all their pens, but it's definitely common enough where I'm trying to help them to address that. So I'm gonna pull the nib and feed out of this pen to show you kind of what's going on. So this is the nib and this is the feed, and there's this tiny little slit that goes in the feed that actually delivers from your converter or your cartridge, which is your ink reservoir. And then the capillary action works the ink through the feed and then it mates up to the back of the nib, and then the slit of the nib carries that ink through to the page, and then it writes. So there's a couple of different things that can be going on when you are having some kind of dry writing flow issues. Sometimes it's the feed, usually it's the nib, because there's just not as many variables with the feed. They're stamped out and they're made, and there's not really a lot to adjust here. The one thing that you really can do is, and I don't recommend that, especially with the Monteverde feeds, is you can take an X-Acto knife and you can cut, or a Dremel tool sometimes, which is even harder, and you can actually widen your feed channel, but it's kind of a recipe for disaster if you do that and you don't know what you're doing and have spares on hand to practice and stuff like that, because it's so easy to overdo it and you can't undo whatever it is you're doing with your feed. So I wouldn't recommend going that route. So yeah, that's kind of the degree of feed tuning you can get into as far as widening the channel. The other thing that you can do is heat setting. So I have a video out there from Noodlers about heat setting an ebonite feed. You actually can heat set a plastic feed as well, which is what you have on this Monteverde one. I don't think that's probably the issue that you're having here, because typically it's when you end up with a broken flow that is kind of an indication that you have a issue with the feed mating up to the nib. A couple of ways that you can test that. If your feed is too far away from the nib and it's not making contact with it, that can break some of the flow. And you can tell by if you have a piece of paper and you are able to fit it in between your feed and your nib, like so, then that means there's too much of a gap there and you'll need to heat set your feed. So I'm really getting deep into this now, but the way that you heat set your feed is you pull the nib and feed out, you heat your feed up. So you put it in hot water. You let it sit there for a bit, and it depends on the feed exactly, because different companies use different plastic, which heats to, you know, different degrees. So you will want to heat it up to the point where it's pliable, and you'll bend it up a little bit, and you'll let it cool. And you don't want to be bending up at like a 90 degrees, but you want it to be noticeably kind of bent up. And then you're going to put it back on your nib, and it's going to intentionally be too high. But then what you do is you set it back in your pen, and then you heat up your water again, and then this time you put it so that just the nib and the feed are in your water, not the whole pen, but just the nib and the feed. And then the pressure from that feed that's bent up too high and the nib that's pushing it down, the pressure as it heats up, it's gonna get pliable again, and it's going to push it back down, and then that feed is going to be pushed right up against the nib. It's gonna cool and it's gonna dry in that position, and that's gonna be a properly heat set bead. So that is a relatively straightforward process that can definitely help. I don't know that that's necessarily the issue with the Monteverde pens. That tends to be somewhat of an issue more with some other pens that I've seen. Not so much an issue with these. I think more what's going on with this nib is it's actually the tines are pinched too close together. And you can actually look at it and you can see, if you can see light in between your tines, then you're generally okay. You don't want your tines to be pinched so close that there's no light. And so if you're looking at the nib like this, you know, kind of straight on, and you hold it up to the light, can you see any light in between there? If it's pinched so close you can't see light, it's definitely pinched too close. And this is when the pen is empty, by the way. When the pen is inked up, you're not gonna be able to see any light through that ink. When you have, you know, the nib is perfectly straight like this and you can really see a gap and the tip is not touching at the top, that's gonna write okay, but it's not ideal, because if you write with any pressure whatsoever, then it's gonna splay a little bit like this and it's gonna break the flow. So that's not really ideal either. And then of course, if it's splayed like that, that's bad, because then your capillary action is gonna wanna work in the reverse direction and it's gonna wanna flow it away from the tip of the nib. That's not good. What you want is you want a little bit of light, a little bit of space where the breather hole is, right here, where the slit starts in the middle of the nib. And as it goes towards the tip, you want it to taper a little bit, like so, to where it just barely touches. That's really kind of ideal. So there are ways to do that. When you get into this level of tuning, I would say this is probably where you may wanna consult some of the higher authorities, if you will. So to follow into your next question, would my warranty with Yaffa cover any adjustments? Absolutely. If the pen is writing really weak and you're having flow issues and stuff like that, Yafa will take care of these kind of things, especially because I've talked to them and been like, hey, our customers are saying they're having some flow things. Can you please help them with that? And they're like, absolutely, anytime. So if you contact them, or if you contact us, if you bought it from Goulet, we'll definitely help you with that. But there's a couple of different ways that you can fix that if the tines are pinched too tight. The easiest thing to do is to actually just kind of flex a little bit. So if you write with a little bit of pressure, hold it about a 45 degree angle, kind of flex it out just a little bit. Don't really go aggressively, but just kind of flex it out. Do a couple of flexes. You know, you can do some short strokes with writing some intentional pressure, and that will work to kind of open up the tines a little bit. You don't want to do it too much, because then you'll end up splaying them, and that's not great. But for stainless steel nibs, you really have to go pretty aggressive to be able to completely ruin it like that. And you can bend it back too. So it's not like if it ever gets out of alignment, you know, you're stuck. But, you know, you always have to use your own judgment. If it's a $100 pen like this one and you're just not that comfortable doing it and you're like, yeah, I don't know, it's always best to just contact, you know, the retailer or manufacturer just to see what's the best plan of action there. But if you're relatively comfortable, you've handled a number of pens, this is something you can definitely do yourself. So try that. Try with the pen inked up. Flex it out a little bit until the flow picks up a little better. And you do want to kind of check the alignment of your tines. That's where you grab your loop and you can kind of look at it, make sure your tines, you know, your tines aren't like completely out of whack like that, because that's going to feel scratchy. So anytime you do an adjustment like this, you always want to check the alignment of your tines too. And that can help. The other method that people use, which is kind of a little bit more complex, is to take an X-Acto knife and actually fit it in between the tines of the nib, and then kind of flex out the X-Acto knife in between the tines and bend to actually separate the tines out. Then you're not risking splaying the tines the same way. However, you are definitely risking scratching your nib. So that is like a whole other thing that I will say you really shouldn't do that unless you're ready to take full responsibility for anything you might do to your nib. But that is a method that is definitely used by several different nibmeisters that are out there to help increase flow of the pen. And then honestly, when the some of the nibmeisters will try to get like a particular exact flow, they'll actually use a feeler gauge, you know, sort of like you'd use for spark plugs, measuring spark plug distances in your car. They'll do that. So they'll use a feeler gauge to check the measurements in between your tines to make sure. But honestly, you can really just visually look and see just by writing with it if it's going to be acceptable or not. But that's one method that's used there. So hopefully that's helpful for you for this week. A little in-depth, may have been over some of your heads, and I'm sorry if that's the case, but that should be pretty decent for you. Okay, what is my time at now? Oh, I am like really trucking along here. I only have one more question. I have a monitor over here, and for whatever reason, I got a new screen, because I also use this for my laptop. I'll dual screen it, and it hooks up to the camera too. But for whatever reason, my like display is not showing up. Like the information that shows me how long my timer is running and all that kind of stuff, it's not on my big monitor. It's only on the tiny little screen on the camera. Anyway, last question I have for this week is from Taylor Norvell on Instagram. And Taylor says, I have noticed recently that the nibs of my pens get out of alignment more frequently than I would think is typical for most users. Read after 2 or 3 sessions with any of my pens. That's a lot. I mean, that's not many. Whatever. That's coming out of alignment pretty often. I notice it happens faster with broader nibs and stubs than finer ones. Is this an issue of writing pressure, or of pen angle to the paper? I think this is going to be more of an issue with writing pressure. The pen angle, maybe not so much. The rotation, perhaps. But really, I think the writing pressure is your issue here, Taylor. So what's happening, if your nib is getting out of alignment, which I'm assuming when you say out of alignment, you mean that one tine is getting pushed up too high and it's writing scratchy. That's what I think of when I hear out of alignment. I don't think of it being a break in flow or anything like that. Out of alignment means that the two nib tines are not lined up anymore. So when that's happening, typically it's because you are writing with more pressure on one tine than you are on another. So really the solution for this, other than fixing it to making sure that it's writing properly in the first place, is just to lighten up. lighten up on your writing pressure. I don't know how new you are to fountain pens, but this is something I typically see kind of a lot from people that haven't had a lot of experience with fountain pens. When you've written for years, decades maybe, with ballpoint and rollerball pens, you're used to like bearing down on that thing and having to write really hard. Particularly if you come over to fountain pens and you don't really know what nib size is ideal for you, and you are using a nib size that's a little finer than what you would actually prefer, and you have a tendency to write with more pressure to try to get that fatter line or to get that, or it can be a consequence of the ink as well. If you are writing and you would really rather have a darker, more saturated ink than what you are actually using, you can have a tendency to bear down too much on it to try to put more ink down. It might even be subconscious too, honestly. So think about that. When you're writing with the pen, literally, you should be holding the pen, but not pressing down with the pen with any pressure whatsoever, just enough to control it. The fountain pen, properly tuned fountain pen, should be able to just write under its own weight. You should be able to hold the back of the pen, and as long as you're holding it in the right rotation and generally in the right angle, you should be able to, I'm using my arm, I don't know why, but you should be able to take and just drag it on the page like this and have it draw a line. That's when you know it's tuned well, and you don't need to write any with any pressure to be able to get it to write. So I would make sure, I would check your nib size to make sure that under that writing pressure that you are happy with the line width, and that's good. Also make sure you're happy with the degree of saturation and the color of the ink. If all that looks good under just that light of pressure, then I would try to train yourself to write with less pressure, because I think that's probably what is going on. And the reason it's getting thrown out of alignment is because you're probably rotating it in your hand a little bit to one side or the other. You didn't say which way it was getting out of alignment, but especially if it's happening with stubs, stubs are a little more sensitive to rotation in your hand, as are broads. So they can get thrown out of alignment easier, because if you think about it, it's a larger surface area with the nib, you know, so if you got this little tiny fine nib, if it's over rotated a little bit, it's not going to get too far out of whack. But you have this stub that's like really wide, if it's over rotated a little bit, it's going to be seriously out of whack, more so than it would be with a finer nib. So I think that's all the things that I have here from you. I think that's what it's pointing to. So try to observe as you're writing, you know, to really see if you are naturally rotating it in one direction or the other. And I think honestly, most people have a tendency, if you're right-handed, you have a tendency to rotate it to the right as you're writing. And so you're going to put more pressure on the right tine. And so you're going to end up with the left tine a little bit lower than the right one. That's where most people have a tendency to do it. And so it's going to feel scratchy going from left to right. So I'm just going to take a guess here that that's maybe what you're dealing with, and you're having to bend that right tine back down because you're probably over-rotating it a little bit, and then you're writing with too much pressure. And if you're over-rotating and it's not writing properly because of the rotation, you're then going to compensate with more pressure, and therefore it's going to get thrown out of alignment. So I think if you can address those things, these are all things you can relatively self-diagnose. But take everything I've said here, try that, and see if that works any better for you. And I'm willing to bet that it will. All right, well, that takes care of this week. I know I've 7 questions is kind of like my new groove. I'm trying to do a little bit like shorter Q&As lately, not quite a full hour, especially because I've just had a lot going on in my personal life, and just tends to be a little bit easier if you're watching me on Snapchat. I'm kind of back on Snapchat now, doing it much more dedicated now. I was up until like 12:30 prepping this video. I started prepping my Q&A questions at 11:40 last night. I didn't want to be doing that late. Did not get up and exercise this morning because I went to bed too late, but that's how much I really love you guys, is I want to get these quality Q&A questions out to you. So that's where I'm at right now. But I think it'll be better next week with, you know, once VBS is over and I'm get half my days back throughout the whole week, it'll be a little bit easier for me to get done the things I need to get done, but still love doing it. It's worth the sacrifice. I'm getting great time with my kids, and it's just really precious time, so wouldn't give that up for anything. So, all right, that's all I got for this week. I do have a question of the week for this week. I'm really curious, jumping back to the first question I answered here, talking about pet peeves. I would love to know what really just irks you about certain pens or inks. So go ahead and leave comments on YouTube or on the blog. Or on Instagram for that matter, wherever you want to leave it. I would love to know, what are your biggest fountain pen pet peeves? So So that's it for this week. You can check out all the products I talked about on GouletPens.com. If you have not subscribed yet on YouTube, I recommend that you do that. You can check us out on Instagram, on our blog, on Twitter, Facebook. We're available a lot of different places. Pinterest, throw another two. I Periscope pretty regularly. I've not been Periscoping quite as regularly lately, but I can. And I'm on Snapchat too, so you can definitely observe all the stuff we have going on in those channels. I hope you have a great weekend. I really do. And I hope you enjoy the 4th of July weekend if you are in the United States. And if you are not, that's okay too, obviously. So if you are having a holiday weekend, I hope you enjoy it. We are going to be closed on the 4th of July here at Goulet. Probably should have mentioned that at the beginning of the video, but we are. It's in our newsletter and all, you know, everywhere. So it'll be good. But I hope you enjoy your weekend and ride on.